This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Well, welcome to another edition of Dreamland. I am so happy to be here with you, as always. I am recovering from a knee replacement. My second knee replacement is going beautifully. I'm amazingly well, considering I've been only 2.5 weeks out at this point. Unfortunately, I got COVID during the last couple of weeks when I was totally isolated. I don't know how it happened, but I did. And I am asymptomatic because I'm fully vaccinated. And nevertheless, it's a struggle right now. But I feel great, and I'm glad to be here. I'm glad you're here. And I am particularly glad that our guest is here, and you're going to find out a little bit more about him in a few moments. He is a very special guy. He has not been on this show since September of 2018, when he knocked our socks off with an incredible book, a compendium of research about UFOs that you will never forget. So if you're a subscriber, go to September of 2018 and look up Rey Hernandez, and you will find him. Rey graduated from Rutgers College. He was a master's candidate at Cornell, a PhD candidate at UC Berkeley. He was the recipient of a National Science Foundation PhD fellowship. He was a professor for 6 years at the New School for Social Research in New York and at the City University. He's currently the director, and this is what we're going to be talking about, of the Consciousness and Contact Research Institute, an academic research institute comprised of more than 25 PhD academics, one of whom is my dear friend, Jeffrey Kripal, and I've got loads of friends in this enormous group. John Klimo, I know, and many, many others. So, well, let's just get to it. And I would like to welcome you to the show, Rey. So here he is, folks, Rey Hernandez himself. I'm so glad you're with us on Dreamland, and I'm certainly looking forward to what I know is going to be a great conversation, because the last time we talked about UFOs, you blew everybody's minds, because not only are you an incredible researcher yourself, you know all of these people who know what they're doing when it comes to the edge. They don't go over it, but you don't need to face the incredible. Rey, let's start by talking a little bit about the last interview, because something interesting happened. That was the one, the book on UFOs. It was Beyond UFOs, The Science of Consciousness and Contact with Non-Human Intelligence. Now, this was quite a journey. But something strange happened, and that was, you reported on that show that the regular UFO community just almost totally ignored the book. Why is that?
Well, Whitley, the book had as its title, Beyond UFOs, The Science of Consciousness and Contact with Non-Human Intelligence. And anytime you mention the word consciousness to a materialist ufologist, all of a sudden they tap out. They will have absolutely. Well, because as you know, the whole long, lengthy history, Whitley, of anytime there's a case involving non-human intelligence, they totally ignored it. It's just like in quantum physics, you know, compute and shut up. You know, they never get into to discussing the consciousness aspects within quantum physics. So with a materialist, their main focus is on, you know, a physical perceived craft, pictures, videos, crashes. But that approach, what have we really learned from 80 years taking that materialist approach? My response is almost nothing. But yet in 5 years of studying academically and statistically, individuals that have seen UFOs and have had a diverse array of contact with non-human intelligence, almost all of our research findings totally contradict the field of ufology. But yet no one has ever studied this statistically, academically.
Okay, what if I say to you, consciousness is a weaver. It weaves the material world. How do you react to that statement? I'm very curious as to what you think about a statement like that.
Well, it depends what exactly what you mean by that. If you're assuming,
well, I mean that, you know, consciousness is the is what is real, and this is its theater, if you will.
Yes, that's why I start off my book, a four-volume book series, A Greater Reality, and in particular, my introductory chapter, which I published as a separate book, and I'm giving away for free the PDF copy of that, titled The Mind of God.
I gather that you can find that on the Greater Realities website?
Correct, yes.
Okay.
And yes.
Website, folks, just hold on, Ray, a second, is agreaterreality.com. That's agreaterreality.com. It's a great, very informative site, well worth deep exploration, as are these extraordinary books, because what they are basically essays from just all kinds of incredible people, because there are a lot of scientists and academics of the highest quality, like my friend Jeff, for example, Kripal, who are into this, doing this. So let's roll back to where we were.
Let me address your question. We start off our book series and my article with a section titled, Is Consciousness Primary? Okay. And I go into that discussion with a whole history of the history of idealism. So we go back from the Vedanta, the Upanishad traditions, the Buddhist tradition, the Egyptian tradition, Greek and Roman traditions, and then even the some of the early Greek philosophers, European philosophers, post-Roman tradition. And then we go into modern philosophies of monism, and even what Jeffrey is known for, dual aspect monism. Not only Jeffrey Kripal, but Jeffrey Mishlov. So,
okay, wait, hold on.
Yes.
Let's pretend that I and my listeners don't have any idea what monism is. So let us clue us in.
It's basically idealism is a whole tradition that goes, as I said before, way back to the earliest writings of humankind, the Upanishads.
And that to say it is that this world is an idea.
Correct. That our physical reality, in the Upanishads, they use the word Maya, you know, that it's an illusion. But basically what we see via our five senses is not our true reality, that there's something much more complex, which is hidden. And that's why I use the term in the book, A Greater Reality. And that is what idealism is, that it's all one integrated phenomenon under consciousness. And then we transition to a different section of our book titled, Is Consciousness Primary? And that's where you have all these articles from these very well-known names discussing the concept of consciousness being primary and not our physical reality.
Now, and so many of them. Let me ask you this. I'm looking at these names. Bruce Grayson, I know of. I know Jeffrey, of course. Let's talk about Jeff Mishlov's idea, an extraordinary experiment. Will Owens produce a UFO for me? Now, what is he talking about here? Because I've read most of these, not all of them, I will admit, because the book is not small. I don't think it's meant to be read all the way through.
No, it's meant that as a resource.
Right, exactly. And so I took it to be a resource. And now, but I was struck by this nature of this experiment. Can you discuss this a little bit? Are you familiar with that essay?
Yes. And that's just one of 11 essays in our UFO section. And that's in volume two. The UFO section is in volume two.
Yeah, we're primarily going to be talking about volume two today, by the way.
Okay. And so in volume two, we have, out of these 11, seven were written by PhD academics and one retired medical doctor. And all of them are arguing that the UFO phenomenon is a consciousness-based phenomenon. Now, what a lot of people don't understand is when we are saying consciousness-based phenomenon, we're saying that it's not physical. We're not saying that. We're saying it's both physical and psyche. And this is a concept that Alan Hynek spoke about, you know, in the latter stages of before his death. Jacques Vallée has been writing about that for 40 or 50 years. You've been writing about that, you know.
Yeah, my new book is very much about that. How that works, you know, on a practical level.
Yeah. And so that's what I also wrote in my book, The Mind of God, with examples from experiencers. And I also go into how the UFO phenomenon is also interrelated with the other contact modalities. And let me very briefly define that term in case some of your listeners do not know what that term is. The contact modalities is the term that I coined in 2013. After I had an extraordinary experience, you certainly know them, that term extraordinary experience. While I was driving my car, going to work at 8:30 in the morning in a freeway, I was basically taken out of my body, taken outside of space-time, given this lesson that all of the quote-unquote paranormal are interrelated. And I was shown that via, I was inside a wheel. And I was seeing these videos of all of these different phenomena, NDEs, UFOs, out-of-body experiences, ghosts and spirits, shamanic journeys, et cetera, et cetera. People communicate with the deceased. And so I then wrote a paper, and it was published in our website that we had at that time, of the Dr. Edgar Mitchell Free Foundation. And so what my book also is presenting, that all of the paranormal needs to be studied as one, getting back to your original question of consciousness being primary. And then within the UFO, what we discovered in the Beyond UFOs book was that, yes, people were seeing UFOs. Yes, they're seeing physical beings, but the overwhelming percentage of their experiences can be categorized as paranormal, as the contact modalities. So like in my case, I've only seen a physical being twice, okay? But yet the vast majority of my experiences can be categorized as paranormal. I've had almost everything in the kitchen sink. And I'm not including, you know, seeing shadow people, seeing ghosts and spirits, because those weren't fully materialized, but fully materialized intelligences. So what we're trying to show in that section on UFOs is that this phenomenon, yes, it's physical, but what's underneath that is a consciousness-based phenomenon, because we were able to determine, just like Jacques Vallée, but we determined it statistically, that these experiences, the UFO phenomenon, manipulated space-time. For example, 50% of the individuals that took our survey, 4,300 people was the total number, were brought to other multidimensional realities. Okay. Not necessarily associated directly when they saw a UFO, either before or afterwards, but within their lives. Okay. They have seen a UFO and they've been brought to other realities like I have. And so that's just one example of a manipulation of space time. But Vallée always talks about it.
He has to them, space-time, I think that they create whatever space-time they wish us to experience. And speaking of experience, free Dreamlanders, listen up and watch and have a great experience. We'll be right back. Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface, among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Vallée says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment of public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Puthoff says, them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them, a new vision and a new way of looking at close encounter. You have never read anything like them before. It is the beginning of a new way of looking at our own future. We're talking to Rey Hernandez today, greaterreality.com. Greaterreality.com. He is got a number of books out, which are the Greater Reality series. And what they are basically resource material for anyone who wants to think about this whole field, not as strictly nuts and bolts, but on a much bigger scale. And I don't know too many close encounter witnesses who don't agree with you that there is something going on here that suggests that reality is a weave woven by somebody else. Now, I'm going to get into who the weavers may be, unless, of course, it's us, because we don't actually know what's going on in here. This thing in here, you know, it has 100 trillion connections in it. 100 trillion. To give you an idea about how big that is, this little old thing in here, there are 200 trillion stars in the universe, the whole universe. So this contains half a universe, just this little thing. Now, it may be doing things that we have no understanding of whatsoever. We don't know what this is, except we do know one thing about it. It's in us, and it came in here from somewhere. It's very different in many respects from the brains of the other primates, even though we are so close to them genetically. That little switch was tripped somehow, and this damn miracle showed up. Now, I want to go back, Rey, to when this all started with you, because you just described a number of brain-bending experiences. You threw them out like they were just nothing, just part of your life. Who in the world are you, man? Where did this start?
Well, unlike the majority of individuals that have had these experiences, they did not start early in life or even middle age. I was 55 years old when they started. And it started with a miraculous medical healing of our paralyzed 15-year-old Jack Russell Terrier, who we were going to be euthanizing. And my wife, the night before, began to pray. That's the word, pray, to the Virgin Mary of Mexico for a miraculous healing. And me being the good atheist that I was at that time, I totally waved it off. And but yet that morning when we both woke up, the dog was still paralyzed. And I went back to sleep and my wife carried the dog down the stairs. And then she started yelling at me, Ray, 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 Ray. And I was like, oh my God, Sunday morning, 6 o'clock, she's waking me up. And then I soon found her upstairs and she was hauling me out of bed physically. You need to see this, you need to see this. And she had seen an object in our living room, but she wouldn't tell me what it was. But once I got down there, immediately she disappeared right in front of me. The dog disappeared. And whatever this intelligence was totally took over my conscious thought. I started looking at the corner of our room, what I call an energy being. And let me describe it to you. It was approximately 2.5 feet in width, about 1.5 feet in height, okay? And waving like a desert mirage, multiple colors inside, semi-transparent. I could see the wall and the sofa behind it. And then all of a sudden I looked at it and then I waved at it. And I said, ah, BS, this is what you got me up for this junk. I'm going back to sleep. And I then turned around, didn't even care. My wife disappeared, the dog disappeared, that I was watching this energy being. And I went upstairs and I remember putting my hands on my chest like this and I was knocked out. An hour later, and I know it was an hour because when I got downstairs, I saw the clock on the wall, it was 7 o'clock. And so I woke up and I immediately ran down the stairs. And then all of a sudden my wife, boom, reappears again. She looks down, she sees our dog running around the entire living room, fully healed. And she starts celebrating in Spanish, the angels cured her, the angels cured her, hallelujah, hallelujah. And to me, it was like an atom bomb blew up. And then that's how it started.
I bet it was like an atom bomb blowing up because you were not in that space at all when that happened.
Not at all.
Here's something fascinating that I did not realize that the Virgin, it's the Virgin of Guadalupe, right?
Correct. Yeah.
She is the patron saint of my mother's family.
Oh, wow.
Very much. And in their wonderful old house in Texas, which has been standing since the early part of the 20th century, 1906, I believe, over the archway between the living room and the great dining room is an image of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And that image, that was very much part of my growing up. So, and you know, and if you look into the story of Our Lady of Guadalupe, it is like Fatima, a story that has been changed into a story about a Catholic religious figure, a Catholic saint, that isn't really about that. Like, you know, I knew a priest who was at Fatima, and he's long dead now, but he saw the disc that appeared in the sky and danced in the sky, and he said it was not the sun. And not only that, he could see figures moving on it. And he was interested. We were friends, basically, because he felt it was a UFO. And those figures were, as he put it, aliens, although I don't know if that's what they were at all. In any case, the being that the children actually described, the Jesuits changed the description to make it sound as if they were talking about the Virgin. And he claimed that the reason that, I believe Lucia, the little girl who survived, retired to a convent was she wouldn't lie and therefore couldn't speak. because she also wouldn't go against the church. So what was that being, my friend? And do you have any sense of who that is? Because it might be very important, and it might lead us to the connection between us and this whole vast array of extraordinary experience, altered reality. So tell us a little bit about your wife and her devotion and what the lady means to her and to you.
Well, what happened, that's sort of like a multi-part question, deserving a multi-part answer.
Right. It's so, let you me go ahead. I'm going to let you, I'm going to give you the stage again.
Okay. Shortly afterwards, the dog woke my wife up at 3:30 in the morning. And my wife usually goes and opens the back door for her to do her necessities. But this time she was jumping on the front door, which she never does unless we have a chain or going out for a walk or going into the car. But this time she was just jumping on the front door frantically. My wife opens the front door. She goes outside and she hears this deafening noise. And then lasts for about a minute. And then all of a sudden she looks up and there's a huge object, like a Goodyear blimp, very close to her. I would say within 100 feet. And she described it in detail. And then she went to Mexico several months later. She spent an entire month in Mexico, and she would be praying at night. And then what would show up? These consciousness aerial phenomena. That's my term for UFO, CAPs. And then she told me about it, and then I tried it. Calling down what at that point I had called it a UFO, but now I think it's something a little bit more complicated. And then during my first experience, that was witnessed by my daughter and three adult friends. And that was when I first realized that what I was watching was actually a holographic projection. And medical doctor, Dr. Joseph Burks, who's been doing CE5, which he calls HICE, Human Initiated Contact Experiences, since 1992. He started with the Stephen Greer Group. And then after like 6 years, he left because of several issues with this gentleman. And so, but he's been calling down UFOs all of his life. And he also reached that conclusion that these were holographic projections. And I think this is important, Willie, very, very important. Jacques Vallée, in one of his books, mentioned that these might be holographic projections. And let me explain in my initial experience. Here I was, my daughter was next to me, these three friends were there, and they began to try to explain it away. And what I was watching was hundreds of oblong streaks of light that formed the whole skeleton of this object. Inside was all this white energy that was fluctuating inside this object. So it wasn't something physical because you could see the stars behind it. It was a totally the clouds, I'm sorry. It was a completely cloudy night. So you could see the clouds behind it. And so so it was semi-transparent. And then my friends were trying to explain it away, giving human explanations for it. And after about a minute, I communicated with this intelligence. And I said, you better come up with some better BS than this because my friends don't believe you. So instantaneously, what I was watching, what I just described to you, totally disappeared and replaced now by these large orbs, very large orbs. All of them at the same time were blinking on and off, on and off, on and off, on and off.
I love it. It's so cool, Ray.
It was incredible. And then they would take turns.
My.
One at a time would blow up like the size of the moon and then get down again. Then another one in another area would blow up and then get down again. And so then my friends stopped, okay? And it was later, once I began processing all this information, that I realized, I said, my God, we're dealing with an intelligence that's able to project something to you. And then with your consciousness, with your thought, you know, you're telling them to get rid of it. This is BS. And boom, something totally different replaced it. And then before that, let me tell you about how my daughter was introduced to this. My daughter was inside her house. She was 10 years old. I'm outside and I'm watching this object. It appeared within 15 minutes of me calling it down. And by calling it down was like pure intent of love, wanting to thank them because they healed our dog. Our dog was like a family member. And so my wife had been calling them down and interacting with them and thanking them. And so I wanted to do the same thing. So in the beginning was killing time because I was waiting for a friend to give me his parking ticket so I could consolidate them in a motion to consolidate. So I'm waiting for my friend. He's late. He doesn't show up. And I'm like, oh, what the hell? I saw this guy the other day, Prophet Yahweh, speaking in Hebrew and calling down a UFO. And this little speck would appear in the sky. So I said, what the hell? Let me give it a try. So I wasn't sincere in the beginning. But then once I got into it, then I became more sincere. And then after 15 minutes in my head, I said, this is crazy. This is, you know, nuts. I need to stop this stuff because I'm going crazy. And so I look up and boom, there's that object. And then I heard a voice, my daughter's voice. Okay. I didn't know what a telepathic communication was or a telepathic download. But the voice said, Daddy, you and Mommy have seen UFOs. Next time you guys see a UFO, you call me, Daddy. Don't forget. Don't forget. So in my head was like.
That came telepathically from your daughter.
Yes.
Where was she at the time?
She was at the house, like 50 feet away. And
so inside, fascinating.
I never spoke to my daughter about this. Never. Okay. But I realized later on, besides the holographic projection thesis, right, was that this intelligence has the ability to upload your consciousness, upload like the Akashic records of your streams of communication with my daughter. And then they were able to then splice it and then send it down again telepathically in a structured sentence. Okay. But I've never spoke to my daughter about this. As far as I know, my wife never did either. Okay. And so I'm yelling at my daughter to come outside, run, run. There's a UFO out here. So she comes out and like with her tongue hanging out. And she said, Daddy, what is that? I said, sweetheart, it's a UFO, but it's hiding. Okay. It doesn't want to be shown with the radar. And so, you know, we were both watching it. Like, we're not scared at all. We were both being entertained. And then my wife comes, the man comes with his parking tickets, but he shows up with his wife and 17-year-old daughter. Okay. And then interesting, within 15 minutes of them being there, all of a sudden they leave. And I didn't even question them leaving. You know, they're watching an event of the life of their lifetimes. And they didn't stay, just 15 minutes. And then it was just my daughter and I. And then after another 10 or 15 minutes of both of us watching this, of these light orbs blinking on and off, on and off, on and off, all of a sudden, I felt like I was being attacked by hundreds of mosquitoes. So I had a white T-shirt on. I had shorts. So I was slapping my arms, slapping my legs, and I couldn't take anymore. And I grabbed my daughter and I said, come on, she got it. Let's go inside. These mosquitoes are killing me. So we go inside and my wife is right at the front door, which is completely open. The dog was right at the front door. The dog never went out. And usually it's one of these little dogs that once they hear people, they're out there, you know, trying to bite somebody and barking to death. So I'm telling her what had just happened. And then I said, and we came inside because these mosquitoes were killing me. And then my daughter turns to me, looks at me, and she said, Daddy, there were no mosquitoes outside. And it was like the Amazing Kreskin. I'm sure you know who he is because both you and I are a similar age, okay? Amazing Kreskin snapped his finger and I woke up and I was like, holy cow, what the hell just happened? I was in a trance, Whitley. So I quickly ran downstairs. I grabbed my professional camera, a video recorder, and I ran upstairs. Nothing was there. So that's how my experiences began. It was after that experience with that UFO that everything just took off. It's just exploded. It was an explosion of paranormal experiences. Willie, I can't hear you.
So your wife calls up this being.
In our living room.
And it all starts basically with Our Lady of Guadalupe, who is no Catholic saint and may not even be a lady. In any case, yeah. But that energy is real. Those entities are very real. It's the same energy that was present at Fatima. No question in my mind about it. Why it chose you and her, or maybe it didn't. Maybe you made the choice inside yourself. And we just don't know. When we get back, I'm going to ask Rey. We're going to get into some of the deeper stuff. I mean, it's not that this isn't deep. This is very deep stuff. I mean, I like to present the deepest stuff in a fun way. And, you know, that's what we're doing today. We're having fun with something quite wonderful that is actually just beyond the edge of accepted human experience, but is very real. And this is where we want to go. Because this thing in here I was talking about earlier wants to go there. This thing is ready to go to the stars. That's what all of this is about. It is about mankind reaching a new level. And it may or may not involve going to other physical planets, but it sure does involve this thing getting a lot bigger and a much bigger relationship with the world and reality. Okay, so anyway, when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about Rey's wife and daughter, and if he doesn't mind, and his past, their pasts, because that all has something to do with this. This is very familial, as most of you close encounter witnesses who listen to this show know. And then we're going to get into what I started to get into a long time ago, which is an extraordinary experiment. Will Owens produce a UFO for me? And because we're kind of, it seems like the show is kind of organically going in the direction of physical relationship between this very definitely ambiguously physical, non-physical reality and us. Okay, on that note, if it makes any sense, and I certainly hope it does, we'll be right back. This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young, I believe that it was kind of blonde, and he was very tall, like at least six feet. And he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months. And I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audio books, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show in its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure.
learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com, click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today.
Mitch Horowitz calls it in the preface, among the most important interpretations of visitor phenomena since Jacques Vallée's Passport to Magonia in 1969. Dr. Vallée says in his foreword, the book cites fact after fact to build the case for in-depth realignment of public policy and public need. Diana Walsh Pasulka, author of American Cosmic, says, leads the way, and it's best that we listen, because the stakes have never been higher. EarthTech International President Hal Putoff says, them is exceedingly valuable. Leslie Kane, author of UFOs, Generals, Pilots, and Government Officials Go on the Record, says, groundbreaking in the truest sense of the word. Bigelow Aerospace VP Colm Kelleher says, searing and masterful. Them. A new vision and a new way of looking at close encounter. You have never read anything like them before. It is the beginning of a new way of looking at our own future. We're talking to Rey Hernandez. A Greater Reality.com is the website. And the books, we're sort of skating around the books a little bit. A Greater Reality, Volume 2, the theoretical chapters, A New Paradigm of Non-Local Consciousness, The Paranormal, and The Contact Modalities. And Rey is so excited, his machinery is singing to him. Anyway, this is fun, Rey. I really enjoy this. You're such a cool guest.
Well, this was Dr. Joseph Burks who was calling me. He's that medical doctor that I mentioned 10 minutes ago. He actually wrote an article in the UFO section saying that UFOs are part of a virtual reality scenario, that we're living inside a virtual reality.
Okay, we're gonna table the discussion. I was gonna begin with your wife and daughter. We'll get back to it hopefully, but on this show, who knows what'll happen? Obviously, the presence has said, "Talk more about this."
Yes, this most definitely.
So otherwise, Dr. Burks wouldn't have been calling you right at this moment, would he?
Most definitely. There are no coincidences, Willie, as you know.
No. We've got this show has at least two hosts, me and Ann. And I got a feeling that whatever our Lady of Guadalupe really is, and the Lady of Fatima really is helping today, too. So let's go to Dr. Burks and tell us a little bit about his contribution.
Well, Joseph was part of the researchers of the Dr. Edgar Mitchell Free Foundation. As you know, we had various PhD academics that conducted the actual academic research study, the statistical research study. We had many other non-academics, people like Kathleen Martin, Mary Rodwell, Barbara Lamb. Leo Sprinkle was an academic, but it was more related to working with experiencers. But we had Dr. Bob Davis, a PhD neuroscientist, Dr. John Klimo, retired professor of psychology, Dr. Rudy Shields, a professor of astrophysics at Harvard, Edgar Mitchell, and several others. And so Joseph was part of that group. And it was about maybe 5 years ago, we had a conversation, and it was basically these big questions as to what the hell is really going on, you know? And so I told Joseph at that point, I said, Joseph, my experiences have taught me that what we're living in is inside a spiritual virtual reality. It's spiritual because immediately after that UFO sighting, I was given a series of near-death experience related experiences, NDE related experiences. Again, another orchestrated series of events where after 4 months of reading hundreds of books on NDEs and academic articles, at the very end, it was 12 hours a day. I wasn't doing any of my work, didn't care about it relating to my family. I was just a crazy madman just reading these NDE books and books on the science of consciousness. And then 3 days in a row, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, October 21st, October 22nd, October 23rd, 2012. Those 3 days, the very first three people I ever mentioned NDEs to, all of them had it. The first one was my daughter's pediatrician, Dr. Claudia Herrera, okay? And the last one was my own father. And he had the most profound NDE of any book I ever read, of any article I've ever read, because he gave me all the details. He told me right off the bat, he said, time doesn't exist. What do you mean time doesn't exist? Well, I was up there 20 or 30 years. What do you mean you're up there 20 or 30 years? Well, that's how long it took God to show me all the good things I had done in my life and all the bad things. He had a life review, except he didn't know the literature. He didn't know the terminology, but he went into all these details. And my mother was next to me after he just stopped talking. He didn't want to talk about it anymore. I asked my mother, I said, did he ever tell you this? Only once when he was coming out of surgery. He had quadruple bypass surgery in his heart. And it was after that last experience that I was on my way home from my parents' house that for the first time in my life, Whitley, I spoke to God.
Oh, wow.
Yes. God yeah, in
that's possible, by the way, folks. God is not somewhere off in the distance.
No. God is
right here.
Correct.
In this part of us.
Correct.
Absolutely.
And so that was the first time I ever spoke to God and to these intermediaries, which I call modern angels. And these are the physical appearances and the messages we get, the experiences. And so since that day, I realized, I learned that I'm an eternal spiritual being, that that I don't fear death. You know, it's just like an NDE experiencer. So Joseph and I were talking about these concepts. I said, Joe, we're living inside a Russian doll, okay? We're the smallest Russian doll, okay, inside, which is our physical reality. But then once we have an out-of-body experience, and I've had those, you go out of your body, you're still dealing with your 4D dimension of planet Earth, okay? You're floating around your house, your neighborhood, you might go to your friend's house, but you're still interacting with the 4D. So I call that the 5D reality. But then once you have an astral travel experience, like I have had as well, you pop out of that astral realm. And I don't know how many astral realms there are in that astral travel experience, but it's like an NDE because it's almost an infinite number of realities that you get brought to, and you're interacting with almost an infinite number of conscious intelligences, okay? And then the realm, which I call the realm of the mind of God, that's where people die and they have an NDE. Their consciousness is interacting with the mind of God. And so that's all detailed in my book. My book is basically about how human consciousness travels up this hierarchy of the astral realms within consciousness. So just think of a Russian doll for your listeners that are out there. Outside of the largest Russian doll, that's the greater reality. That's the mind of God. So anyway, I'm explaining all of this to Joseph Burks. And then he goes, Ray, and I ended by saying that we're inside a virtual reality, but not a virtual reality that is discussed like in computer sciences, inside a computer. I said, no, it's way, way more complicated than that. And it also deals with all the history of idealism that all of the ancient, you know, wisdom seekers have known. And as you alluded to earlier, all of the major experiencers know this. It's not anything.
Absolutely. New. It is basic.
It's basic. It's like, it's the way I explain it is like, duh, you know, when are you going to tell me something new? You know?
Right, exactly.
And so we're having this conversation with Joe. And mind you, he's having a lot of experiences himself. And so he's Ray. He said, Ray, I've reached the same conclusion. So I said, look, Joe, I'm going to be writing this series of books. It's going to be a compendium of different articles. I want you to put together an article that talks about your thesis that we're living inside a spiritual and virtual reality. And so he wrote it regarding UFOs, the UFO phenomenon, because that's what he's basically interacting with. And so that's Joe giving me a call right now. We speak every week, sometimes a couple of times a week. But he's a major experiencer. He's a retired medical doctor, and he understands the consciousness-based aspects of ufology. To me, when I refer to who we are, I don't refer to our mind, because you could be dead on the floor, okay? And you'd be floating above your dead body. And then you're just like saying, who's that person underneath there? But so your mind, physical brain might not be working, but your consciousness, what is the philosophers called the mind, okay, is still interacting. These are concepts that within ufology are rarely discussed, Whitley, as you know. They're discussed.
Never.
They're discussed within religion.
This is the whole ball game.
It's the whole ball of wax, okay?
Right. But listen, you know, I want to have Dr. Birx on the show because I think we've been directed toward doing that. So after we're done, you get me in touch with him and I'll see if he wants to come on the show. Free Dreamlanders, I have very bad news, and it is bad news because we got to cut you off. You know, so many people watch free. I hate to stop doing the free part of the show, but at the same time, subscribing to this thing is $5 a month. I mean, it's one of the cheaper ones around. It's not a big deal. And also, as I've said many times, if you can't afford it, we give you a free subscription for 3 months. And usually the subscription lady, if you come back to her, said, I'm loving this show, and she sees you actually are active and going on the site. I want more time. She gives you more time. We're very generous about that. But you got to step up because I can't, you know, I'm an old guy. And I'm an old guy with COVID. I need my friends to step up. So you do that. So goodbye today, Free Dreamlanders. I love you very much, and I'm so grateful you spent time with us. Subscribers, we're going to get deeper. We're going back to that family. Where do they come from? Why did this being that we think of as the Virgin, because that idea has been imposed on it by religious groups, come to the Hernandezes? Where do they come from? Fascinating stuff. The website is agreaterreality.com. You can get all the books through their website. And the wonderful thing, you page through this thing. Raymond Moody. Here is Ray's interview with Raymond Moody. Jeffrey Long, an interview with Jeff Long. Sharon Rollette, the best evidence for the survival of human consciousness. Michael Grosso, the great Michael Grosso, UFOs, psychical research, and religion. You don't have to read the whole thing or the many whole things because there's a whole bunch of them, but what a resource to just sit down and open it and let these essays kind of talk to you. Which one wants me to read it? How do I use this for my growth? Just get the books. Okay. Bye, Free Dreamlanders. I love you.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.